Hey, River Church, it's Tim. I'm here at Ben's Beans, ready to continue in our study. Right now we're going through the book of Philippians. We're trying to do passage by passage to try to make it as straightforward as possible, but also to give us an opportunity to practice skills in learning to use this text, to be able to use any text. So what we're using is a four-step process. The first step that we use is to look at the passage and try to understand what has the author intended for the original audience. We're talking about the book of Philippians, so we're talking about what did Paul mean for the church in Philippi. Second step is to examine the differences in culture between the present and the biblical audiences. What this would mean would be understanding what did God mean through Paul to Philippi, and what is the difference that separates that message to a message for us today. Once you've separated out the cultural differences, we can look for what is the theological principle in the text. What is the message that God has that transcends time, location, audience, etc.? The last step is, how should this be applied to our lives? And this is where there's a lot of flexibility. In steps 1 and 2, there's a pretty straightforward answer. The question is, how do we find out the most we can? Then step 3, where we're finding out what the theological principle in this text is, it depends on our text size. If we're talking about the whole of the book of Philippians, there's a couple themes, but when we start diving in, we're going to actually start delving into one of the themes today. So the anticipation is that you have at least glossed over the passage. Today we're going to be doing Philippians 1, 12 to 18. It kind of cuts off at the end, but that general section is what we'll be covering. Now, if you haven't had time yet, I recommend you pause it for just a second and go back and try to read that following these four steps. But what I want to do today is I want to help flesh out steps 1 and 2. That is to understand what the author intended for the original audience and examine the differences in culture between present and biblical audiences. One thing that's really nice, using a book from the New Testament, specifically the epistles, we're reading a message from a planting pastor to his church. This is pretty easy to contextualize. So there's not a huge difference, but we do need to understand what was originally there. So let's dive right in. I've got quite a bit to get through, and I really am ambitious to try to save time as well. So the first is that the theme of this book, this section in particular, one of the key themes of the book is the power of the gospel of Christ. This particular passage, we're going to be addressing two kind of sub-themes, the power of the gospel in chains and the power of the gospel in divisiveness. So the first is at the beginning, the first half of it, we're seeing verses 12, 13, and 14. What he's talking about at depth is his imprisonment and the gospel through it. So what's important is in verse 12, he says, "I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel." This advance the gospel is key because what he's talking about is imprisonment, and what you would anticipate to hear is that this has hindered the gospel. In the Greek, this term is very similar. What you'd expect him to say was proskope, which is to hinder, but what he actually said was prokope, to advance. And so he used this slight rhyme to be able to show that no, it didn't hinder, it advanced. What's also significant, especially as we're moving on, is when he's talking about his imprisonment. If you look back, and I don't want to use too much Greek. I feel like it muddies it sometimes. I probably use it here and then a little bit in early 2, chapter 2. But what he does talk about in 13 is that when he talks about what his imprisonment is for Christ, the Greek, the way it's laid out, is this idea that his chains... He was well known for his chains in Christ, that the message of the gospel is advanced because that he is well known. His chains are not from Caesar, though he's imprisoned by Caesar. His chains are from Christ because Christ had a purpose in his imprisonment. So then we further move on. In that passage, just to read it, it says, "So that it's become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ." We're seeing that while he is in chains, the gospel's being spread exactly where he's at. When he's not in the ideal situation, the people that surround him are still hearing the gospel. And then 14, it says, "And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear." Again, this contradicts what you'd anticipate. If we heard that Pastor Josh had gone to prison for the advance of the gospel, a lot might anticipate that things would quiet down. But what happens in Christ and in his imprisonments is the exact opposite, that people are emboldened, that they're able to share the gospel without fear. When he talks about this, that these are brothers that are greatly emboldened. These are people that were already doing the thing that they needed to do, but they were given greater confidence and greater ability. So now we're going to switch. We're going to continue to talk about these brothers, people in faith with Paul, people that believe in the same exact gospel and ultimately the same mission coming from different angles. And so we jump forward to 15. It says, "Some indeed preach Christ from envy and rivalry, but others from goodwill." And we'll dive into these in a sec. So when we see this, these two terms, envy and rivalry, it immediately invokes Titus 3, what Paul had said there. He talks about envy in verse 3. It says, "For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another." And then later in 9, he says, "But avoid foolish controversies, genealogies, dissensions, and quarrels about the law, for they are unprofitable and worthless. And for a person who stirs up division, after warning him once and then twice, have nothing more to do with him." And so Paul's opinion on these two particular sins, in envy and rivalry, is very clear from Titus 3. And so we're talking about brothers who are disobedient by being envious and creating division. So then what he does is an interesting little structure. And this is something that if you're going to be doing these first two steps, it could be pretty important. When you see where Paul is talking about one thing, then something different, that same thing, and then something again different. This is called a chiastic structure. It uses the chi letter that looks like an X, and it follows like an angle. So what he ends up doing is he starts with talking about that some have preached Christ from envy and rivalry, then moves in, but others from goodwill. He talks about them again. He says the latter do so out of love, knowing that I'm put here for the defense of the gospel. And then back, the former proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, but thinking to afflict me in my imprisonment. This seems a little bit complicated, but in the Greek writing, this would have been significant to point towards the obedient, which is interesting when we understand Paul's imprisonment. So the point I want to make out of this is, if we go to 12, he talks about, "I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me, has really served to advance the gospel." From that point on, he only talks about the gospel. What he's talking about is his chains. He mentions it a few other times. If we take someone from today and they go into prison, and even if it's for their beliefs, most of the time the discussions surrounding it, the news articles and the reports, they all surround what was the treatment like and why were they there? What do they feel? What are they missing? And all these things about the imprisonment. But Paul doesn't want to talk about the imprisonment. Likewise, Paul doesn't want to talk about the dissenters. He talks about these people who are doing things selfishly to point towards those that are doing it obediently. Because what is important to him is the advance of the gospel. Now, the other thing I want to point out, and this is really, really important, is that these people that are preaching out of envy and selfishness, trying to advance themselves, these are brothers. These are people that preach the true gospel. They are not, there's two terms that are used for heretics, Judaizers or libertarians. Judaizers being those that try to force Judaism onto Christ. And so they've forever, the church, the people of God, had had the rules from the Old Testament. They had the law of God, and they were obeying those things. When Christ came, it is said that he was the end, the goal of the law, that he fulfilled it. Because of that, that law doesn't weigh on us anymore. Though that's why we don't stay obedient to the things found in the book of Leviticus or in Exodus. We're able to be free from that. But the Judaizers wanted to continue to oppress that. In Philippians 3, we're going to see that Paul blasts these people. He's not blasting these brothers. So it can't be the Judaizers. But he also goes off on the other group of people. These are absolutely on the other end of the spectrum called libertarians. People that want the abundance of sin and freedom from law. And that simply isn't what Christ has called for. And so these two groups of people, Paul makes very clear, are heretics, that they are outside of the church. People that put too much law or no law. Legalism or depraved freedom. While we may not use these same terms today, while we may not necessarily know someone who falls under these extremes, we do know people that have made the gospel what it isn't. Either a freedom to be able to sin as much as they want, or they've made rules a big part of the gospel. The gospel is freedom. Freedom from sin in Christ, that we can be restored. And Paul makes this very clear. So what we are talking about is people preaching the gospel truthfully. So then the last verse we're going over is Philippians 1:18. It says, "What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice." All this to say, these updates, these details, these honestly negative things, he's not getting caught up in this. He knows that the work of Christ is bigger than the details. That what God is doing is continuing to work in people's hearts. Regardless of sinners, people that are trying to advance themselves or maybe develop a bigger following than Paul, God's also bigger than Caesar's imprisonment. Because in the end of the day, that was an imprisonment for Christ so that Paul could advance the gospel. So with this background, I really encourage you, if you have a sec, pause it, read through the passage again. Because our next step is to go ahead and transition into what is the theological principle in the text. Again, this is really one of those passages that's kind of nice. It's pretty clear that God is trying to say something eternal to the church of Philippi. What he wants to say is that his gospel is absolutely powerful, and that it is ours to preach. So church, what does this mean for us? Application, I really want to leave open. The fourth step in this process is, how should this be applied to our lives? Now, the question is, how are you going to apply this to your life? And if you're with your family, or if you later want to discuss this with your family, what is this idea of the gospel and the power of it and our responsibility to preach it? How is that going to be applied to your life? As a church, we're blessed because we have well-meaning people in our church. We don't have to worry about the divisiveness, the dissenters that are trying to gather up a following for themselves. We have people that mean well. Now, I can't speak for everyone, but maybe there are some that have different ideas on what the gospel includes. And so that's where we can begin, making sure that we're all on the same page, that we know what Christ has said and what his message is. If we've got all that squared away, we got good meaning people preaching the good word, the last step is to preach. It's our responsibility to share the gospel, and we need to go ahead and do that. Now, what this means for you could be a million different things, but for us as a church, our responsibility is to share the gospel. With everything going on with the coronavirus, this is going to look really different than it normally would, but it doesn't mean it has to stop. In prison, Christ continued to advance the gospel through Paul. So if we're in a form of prison, in our quarantine, why can't God continue to advance the gospel? Well, Reverend Church, I appreciate your time. Go ahead and close up. Next week, we're going to be going over what is amazing, like the proof text of the book of Philippians. We're going to be in chapter 1, verses 19 to 26, the proof text, the most powerful point everything hinges on is verse 21, where Paul says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." That idea will weigh heavily on us after understanding the full weight of what the gospel meant to Paul in that prison cell. Now, lastly, if you do want to enjoy the memory verses, this week's memory verse will be Philippians 1:18. This was really the central message of this text that we worked through. Once again, that's "What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice." Wilmer Church, I appreciate your time. I love every one of you, and I'm really excited that we're able to do this together, even at a distance, and I am praying for you. You guys have a good week.